navigating right here towards the thickest, more technical, potentially bothersome aspect of what we're doing here in our certification, having Mark represent. I'm not going to hold you accountable for all the nuanced details. To the extent that I do, I'll spell it out right at the front. You got to make it sense. I don't want anyone to sweat or think that you prep Sisher Dash and Cycle schematic for a certification. I'm not about that. Again, these foundations are important here because they will, for one thing, they're going to give you a lexicon and give you a vocabulary about which you can talk to this to superiors, to your chargers, to your cadets. You're going to be able to explain to them the why and how of what we're doing. It will come up, it does. The differences in interactions are actually found on page 7 of the CrossFit Foundations, which was in the earlier part from the site. It's on page 7. We talk about it at fair length under aerobics and anaerobics and continues on to the next page. I think that is very well stated there. I would highlight it and read that and think about it. It'll resonate well with your experience in here and your experiences with athletes. And also on the CrossFit Journal October issue, if you flip forward, on pages 3 and 4, under metabolic conditioning or cardio. There we are talking at length also with a cool link. Remember, you guys can email me, and I'm going to send you the PDF version of this so you'll have all the links, because this journal is seriously web-enabled. And that there's a journey, a tremendous odyssey throughout the internet here by following our links. But those are some additional references for you, and I'll get you going and moving in the direction of further research in this material if you want, if that's what you're looking for. I want to talk about the differences now and characteristics of anaerobic and aerobic exercise. And by the way, none of this is, of course not, proprietary. This isn't CrossFit stuff. This is just basic exercise science. You can find this stuff. There's nothing debated here. When I talk about these are the 10 physical skills and you want them all balanced, I'm sure there's someone out there doesn't think you need a balance. But this other stuff we're talking about here, the difference between anaerobic and aerobic stuff, it is just non-debatable. Just like the quadratic equation is a solution to quadratic equations, the quadratic formula is a solution to quadratic equations. It's not a debatable issue. If you know the stuff, you know that to be the case, and it is not debated amongst sane or credible or knowledgeable people. Anaerobic exercise. It is high power. Well, you can see that in the graph, right?
That's higher than these.
These are higher. This is power. Do you see in the graph in there, by the way, in the journal, the graph there, the axis was percent contribution, and it has to total 100, so it has them all high, and it doesn't really reveal what I wanted to reveal. In other words, out here, this one's gone, so it has to be 100%. And what you'll find at any point here, this plus that is 100. This plus that point there on the graph is 100. Right in here where we have all three working, you'll find if that's at 80, that's probably 10, and there's another or 15, and that's a 5 or whatever it would be, F. So it has to be 100, because at any point, your total energy is 100. So there's a little difference in the graphs, right? It's really not critical. This one is low power. Now let me digress again about power, one more time. I told you it's the first derivative of work, it's work per unit time, it's not just fast, not just strong, but fast and strong. I'll tell you what else power is. It is most exercise physiologists' definition of intensity. Now I know you all heard about intensity, exercise intensity. In the bodybuilding community, they think it's how hard you grunt. It's a lot of intensity, whereas there's a little bit of intensity. Some people think it's puking or not. Some people think it's how discomforted you are. Actually, if you want to find out what is intensity, is defined in exercise physiology parameters as power. Right? Check this out. If we turn to the literature to try and find out what aspects of exercise increase some quality or diminish it, for instance, let's look at bone density. Turns out some exercise has a dramatic impact on bone density, improves it. Others does not. it will turn out that higher intensity exercise has a greater impact on bone density than lower intensity exercise. This is true of losing fat, of building muscle, of alleviating depression. If we went to our whole big list of things, our 10 general physical skills, what you find is that the way to bring those on quickest, the way to optimize those things, is with greater intensity, not less. Anaerobic exercise is that domain. That is just irrefutable. What are its chief drawbacks? What's it? No, that's true. But they both do. I don't want to go there. It's discomfort.
Well, that too.
Yeah. Really uncomfortable. Compared to this, I mean, I'll squat on limb. It's even fun. No, but I know guys all day long and want to get up in the morning and jog on West Cliff and take the dog and the wife, and jogging is fun. Nobody thinks 1,000-meter efforts on the rower is fun. If you do, you're a liar, or you're rowing poorly, or you're start raving mad. And I want to see it. I would venture to guess that even the seriously mentally ill would not think that's fun. I don't know. I don't even like to get beat up at 9 bars. Wouldn't think that's fun. Okay? I've always believed that a good anaerobic athlete could put his hands in his pockets and walk up to a 5-gallon plastic bucket full of water and stick his head in and drown himself, not pull out. That's the kind of willpower that's required to endure anaerobic efforts. We don't advertise that aspect of our program much. It doesn't draw a lot of people through the door, but it's true. If you can give me good 1,000-meter efforts on the rower, good 800-meter efforts out on a track, if you're that kind of guy, if you can thoroughly exhaust these anaerobic pathways with a smile on your face, then you are the real deal. To the extent that you can engage in this and not give up, you will also become supremely fit, because you are working out in a high power range where the intensity is great, and that focus is where all the results come. Now, there are people in the exercise physiology community that will tell you that because of this, this is better. Now, if we got a choice, say, here's my option. Ted asked me, you work with my mama, she's just real sweetheart, but she's out of shape and she needs some help. And so, am I going to put her on a rower and scream at her and make her roll? She may roll, will she ever come back? No. But could I get her to just sit there and stay comfortable and talk to her and flip on Fox News and let her kind of space out? Would she do that? Yeah. Now, in that case, what I got is the possibility to get some physiological response versus having to go home and hate me. I'm going to go with this. But that's not really what we're after here back home. We're not looking to make people comfortable. What we're looking for is to turn men into steel. And that's done with higher intensity work. And it's only fun when we stop. And it's only fun to the extent that we have camaraderie and support. It's fun in the acknowledgement that we're improving. It's fun in the community that it builds and knowing that you've done what you've done. It's a very cerebral kind of thing. Over time, your capacity for it will increase. Your tolerance for the discomfort will increase. It does become better. All the while, it gets worse and worse because you go harder and harder. It's really amazing. People ask sometimes, does it ever get easier? We tell them, no, it gets harder and you perform better. It never gets easier. Let's look at some other qualities. Here's one that is famous for fat burning. In the bodybuilding environment, they love to sit on that life cycle and spin off the last few pounds. Hours at a time. How often have you heard that about you go long distance? In fact, your long high volume advocate is going to speak glowingly of the fat burning. Guess what, folks? This is a better fat burner. Now, let me qualify this. It's somewhat a complicated subject, but it is also no longer in dispute. And I have referenced the site that links you to the studies that make this point in the CrossFit Journal. In October, on that page 3 and 4 there, you'll see that material. Clarence Bash's site is where it's covered, and there are other places. This will burn more fat while exercising, without a doubt. This will burn less while exercising. the benefit of the aerobic work stops immediately on completing the assignment. You go out and run a marathon, you stop, your fat burning stops within minutes of stopping the marathon. The impact here will stay with me 12, 18 hours. This approach, because of the intensity, delivers a wicked, a wonderful kick to my metabolism that this does not. And the specifics of that are in that article, and it is really amazing. In fact, what it turns out is that in total, we have almost nine times, and this is done by scientific study, almost nine times the fat burning capacity in anaerobic work than we do aerobic. Now, there's another facet to this, and that is that anaerobic work builds muscle. Sprinters are fit not only because of the time they spend in the weight room, but because the activity itself is inherently anabolic. And it will create muscle mass. Guess what the aerobic stuff does? Guaranteed. Promise. Don't think for a minute that those miles looked that way because they were born skinny and being that pathetic, there's nothing they could do but run miles, and so they fell into it. If I take a 350-pound guy and train him to become a proficient miler, when we're done, he's going to be one of those guys where I can see ribs underneath the pecs, where they shouldn't be pecs. This one burns muscle. This is perfectly well understood by the exercise physiology community and largely ignored by a good chunk of the coaches, amateur coaches, and by the gym community. What's going on in other goals and worlds and spa and other programs. This is going on with your guy that advocates long distance stuff. Talk to him about that. But would ask him, like, well, what is the impact on aerobic activity in terms of lean body mass? What does it do? What does it do to muscle? Ask. There has been an attempt made, and this was a classic in the bodybuilding environment, to work out with weights Monday, Wednesday, and Friday, and Tuesday, Thursday, and Saturday to run long distance. And to tell us, well, geez, on the one is I'm building muscle, and the other is I'm getting cardiovascular fit. You know, largely what you're doing is undoing the one with the other. And you end up with a net result that is less than optimal. I can take steroids and get away with a lot of that, though. I can mask a lot of that impact with steroids. I can take a big, big, thick, strong guy and run on marathons with steroids. We'll give him enough steroids and the right stimulus, he might build a good chunk of that muscle mass. The rest of us, a normal population, healthy population, that won't be the case. There was a moment in our development that I almost had thought when we were prepping for this that I was going to mention, and that was the story of TJ. You think you know what's coming with that? When we did a thing for a California Commission on Police Officer Standards and Training called CPOST here, and we had been invited year after year to come up to Evergreen College and talk to the 19 Academy PT directors. And we had asked them in our last appearance there it was a couple years ago, to who is the best of the best, the fittest of the fittest. And there was this kid out of the SO in Bakersfield, and his name was TJ. And TJ is a stud. He reminded me in look of Greg, but not in capacity, it turned out. Because Greg's CrossFit and TJ wasn't, it turned out. But he boasted of a very fast mile, and he was just thick. He looked like a bodybuilder. So we put him through a program. And none of us remember to this day exactly what it was. There was so many routines, but it was typical CrossFit stuff. He was thrustering and sitting up and pulling up and pressing overhead and cleaning or whatever. We had about four or five elements, and we combined them all together, and we sent TJ at the thing, and we all watched. First round looked great. Second round, he slowed down. Third round, he dropped to his knees. He fell to the floor. And he scared the hell out of me. He was non-communicative, he was dry heaving. He rolled onto his side, his comrades came to his rescue, they got him outside, and he held onto the rail, and just as things looked okay, Lauren and I said, well, this would be a great place for lunch. So she and I went over to Carl's Jr., and I started working on getting fat, eating carbohydrates. We come back an hour later, right on time, and the crowd around TJ is now larger, and he's worse. Yeah, and they're wanting me, should we call the paramedics? Well, I didn't know if they should or not. And he was communicative again, and guess what? I haven't spoken with him in over a year, but I bet she's still doing our program. But you know what's interesting? He told us that's what police work should be about. He knew right then, sent us the sweetest little email, that he knew he'd been barking up the wrong tree. Sure, he's got a big bench press, he's got a fast mile, but how you hold up when those stressors are combined, that is critical. Keep your 500-pound bench press, keep your 4-minute mile, give me the capacity to bench moderately heavy at screaming high heart rates and come away with a clear head and a strong body and the capacity to do it again, and to do it again, and to do it again. How else? Just better than anyone else, that's all. You don't have to be perfect, you just have to be better than the others. Which gets me back to my statistical model in the hopper.